Independent Futures in 2012, has an adult sibling and a child with disabilities. Building a career combining, building a career combining health, business, and law, she has worked in hospital research, community health nursing, and starting and managing healthcare businesses. Ann's health law practice, practice focused on merger and acquisitions and healthcare management issues. Ann earned her JD from Loyola University School of Law, her nursing diploma from Henry Ford Hospital School of Nursing, and her Bachelor of Science degree in Healthcare Administration from University of Michigan Flint. She remains active with multiple charities, I don't know how you do it, Ann, primarily focused on children and services for individuals with developmental disabilities. And her colleague, Jackie Eddy, has her MBA and is a trainer and marketing manager for Center for Independent Futures. Jackie has worked with the Center for Independent Futures since 2002 in the areas of marketing, communications, product development, and training. Jackie holds a BA in art from St. Cloud University in Minnesota and an MBA from Northeastern University in Massachusetts. Jackie brings 18 years of experience in general management, marketing, and training to her work with the Center for Independent Futures. Please help me welcome Jackie and Ann.
Much for giving us this opportunity to come today. We wanted to just quickly go through and give you an idea of what we're going to cover as we go through the presentation.
So we're going to go through some quick introductions. We're going to talk a little bit about Center for Independent Futures, housing for individuals with disabilities, our community living options, what we've created, and then also the New Futures Initiative training that we've done with a number of different family groups to help them come together and create housing in their communities. And then we'll have a short time to do some questions and answers. So, moving forward, I've got questions because I want to know, I know we're all parents, I guess that's an inclusive, not just a royal use, but how many people in the room here, your loved one, your child, is still in high school?
Including transition?
Yes, up through the transition program there, freshman to senior to transition. Okay, how many are already have transitioned out and are in some type of post-secondary program? Okay, how many of you have, your children have had an opportunity to have a work experience? And when I'm talking work experience, I'm talking about have they had a competitive employment experience? Okay. How many are concerned about the social and recreational life for your kids?
Not having one.
Could go both ways, right? But more the concern of long-term in life, having one. Relational type life. How many have that? Any concern there? And then, how many of you believe your child wants to live independently? And how many of you would like to see your child live independently? Okay? Because we always think that both of those are requirements for that to happen. How many believe your child today is ready to be thinking about living independently? 5, 6. And then how many of you here have already made sure that you're on the PUNS list? Okay. I wanted to also quickly go through about us. So you already heard a little bit about me, but I think probably often for myself on a daily basis, if you ask me if I were to describe myself, I guess I really do start as saying a mom, a sister, and an aunt. And I guess I've always kind of lived my life with individuals with disabilities. And because of that, you know, my mother, I think, was such a pioneer, and I don't even think she knew she was. But when my sister was born many years, she's in her 50s now, I'm the oldest daughter in a family of 9. Our sister Jean is number 5, so she's the middle child. When she was really approached and said that Jeannie, because of her IQ, because of her ability, should absolutely be put in a group home and should only, you know, would be needed to be in a sheltered workshop, a closely supervised sheltered workshop. At that time, my mom just said, you know, I don't think that's what Jean wants. And, you know, sometimes I attribute it to my mother being a farm girl. But it was kind of like, I think we're just going to give this a shot. And you know what? If it doesn't work out, we know where you are. We'll give you a ring. And as the years went by, fortunately, and I think having 8 siblings is really an incredible blessing. I really do believe that. But I think it was also a blessing for my sister in that she was able to really ultimately end up with a small home in our hometown. She had the support of family, support of network. She ended up being a nursing assistant in our local hospital. After a couple years of getting training in a nursing home and a lot of persuasion, but when you have 10 people on your team giving persuasion from all aspects, things can happen more. And she just recently retired from that position. So she's gotten married in her 40s to someone she had gone to special ed with. And now they continue to live together, the married couple in town, with a wonderful, rich life. To me, that is really person-centered. To me, that is what I want for my daughters. It's what I want for my son. It's what I want for my nephew. It's what I think we want for all our kids, right, is to have that full, rich life. So that, if you ask me, that's who I really am. I know there's that other stuff they say, but I really come to my everyday of my life with that, and then looking at how I now create supports for my son, who is a junior in high school, but, you know, will be moving into transition and thereafter, and how I create those supports without having 8, unfortunately not having 8 siblings to give him. Only 2, but they're 2 good ones. And then Jackie, as you just heard about, has been with CIF from the beginning. So she is just a wealth of historical perspective. And Bonnie DeHone is one of those families that I get to say I work around heroes every day, because they are those parents who continue to forge those paths for all of us to have new and different opportunities and new dreams to be dreaming for our children. So Bonnie will also speak about some of her path in really working with creating that alternative housing opportunity. So Jackie is going to start covering over some of the historical. So great to be here today. So I just want to give you a little bit of background about us so that you know kind of where we come from. So this is our vision statement. We uphold a vision for the future where individuals with disabilities have access to all opportunities of a full life. This is Matt, who's one of the individuals who we support in Evanston. And we've been a not-for-profit since 2002. The idea actually started with 2 moms, just kind of like the organization you're sitting here who invited you today, who said, there is nothing out there. They pulled up at a stoplight, looked across, saw each other, and went, oh, rolled down the windows and said, what's your daughter doing? Oh, she's at home in the bedroom. And the other one said, mine too, we better have coffee. So these women came together and said, there's nothing out there that our daughters would like, and nothing we're real comfortable with. So, you know, we got to create something ourselves, because we need to have something for our children. And if we don't do it, nobody's going to do it. So we support individuals with disabilities and their family. We're a family-driven organization. We started with, the first thing they did was pull together groups of families, like this group of families, who all then started to work together to think about how they were going to create something different. Okay, so it was, again, founded by moms from professionals. Jane happened to have a PhD in transition, and Kay Brantz was her partner at the time, who had an MBA from Kellogg. So the two of them kind of came together and said, we got to make a difference here. We're going to make something happen. Okay, so, I'm going to back up now. So this is our mission. We inform innovative partnerships to create product and service models that give adults with disabilities and their families the skills and opportunity to realize full lives. So when we say we create partnerships, one of the first things we did was look around. We said, okay, who's out there doing this across the country? Who's doing something different than state solutions? What can we look at and learn from? And we found an organization called Toward Independent Living and Learning in Massachusetts, who helped us to kind of get a picture about what might be possible. And in addition, other partnerships that we formed, we looked around for who's working on social capital for individuals with disabilities, building networks of people, because once the family network is not
there to support them. They need other networks. Who's doing that work and who's doing that well? And there's an organization in Canada called PLAN, and they are really great at this. And so we went up and visited them and talked with them and took some of their training. And then the next thing we did was said somebody who's right in our backyard, Northwestern University, who's really good in that organization that we might want to tap into. And what we found there was something called the ABCD Institute, the Asset-Based Community Development Institute. It's all about working with people to come together to create new solutions when there aren't things that they need in their community for their lives and for the lives of the people they love. So we found these organizations. That's how we partner with other people. So our core values, individuals with disabilities are entitled to opportunities for all aspects of a full life. Create something new that incorporates natural supports. Planning is the key to success. Individuals and their families provide leadership to where you're headed and what you're going to be doing. And relationships and networks are essential to a full life and to robust communities. Our approach is grounded in this model, which is called the full life model. And at the center is always the individual's hopes and dreams. And if you're at all working with agencies and schools right now, I hope they're talking person-centered processes and person-centered planning, because they're all going to have to very quickly because of the laws that are coming about for them to get funding. But we are very focused on person-centered processes. So it starts with what is the individual hope and dream for themselves, and what are their families hope and dream with them, for them as well. And then we look at what would make up a full life. Are we in fact looking at all the aspects of a full life? What am I doing in terms of relationship, in terms of fun and talents, my wellness, keeping my wellness, physical, spiritual, psychological, emotional wellness, getting around, how do I get around, how am I engaged in the community? How do I volunteer or earn my way or offer back? And then what areas am I continuing to learn in? And then how do I work to learn and know about my own place? How do I live in it? How do I keep it up? What do I do to be able to live independently? We believe anyone can live independently. It's a matter of what supports need to be put in place. Okay. Our goal for each is for individuals to reach their greatest potential and become contributing members of the community. Our models emphasize choice. We believe individuals learn best through experience. Our products and services, the way we work with people, encourage responsibility, and our work is grounded in relationship. We have something that we call when we work with individuals, when we work with, we believe individuals have the right to and should have the dignity of risk. That means they get to try, and if it doesn't work out, then they learn something about that, just like you and I. That it is something that people can learn from experience. We come from a very educational focus in the work that we do with the individuals that we work with. And so it's all about learning skills, working through experiences. So we're going to give you a minute to meet one of the individuals that we support. His name is Jonathan Schumann, and Jonathan tells his story better than anybody, so we're going to turn on a video and have you hear from him.
CIF is there to really help individuals with disabilities and their families create new options, new solutions.
We really want to attack the challenge that too many people with disabilities experience, which is social isolation.
We always want our individuals to be learning, and we want to be learning about them, learning with them.
CIF has always been focused on what is it this individual wants to do and supporting them living that dream.
All right, Jonathan, I'd like you to tell me your name, how old you are, where you're from, and about your family.
My name is Jonathan Andre Schumann. I'm 25 years old. I was born on March 15th. It's the historic date in Roman history where Julius Caesar was stabbed by his son.
I'm that guy.
Most people who meet Jonathan are surprised by the amount of factual information that he has. He just knows a tremendous amount of stuff. In the West Coast, there are more animals like elk and bison and caribou and doll sheep.
He is constantly asking me questions beyond the scope of just tutoring, like philosophical things, like, do you believe evil truly exists? And that blows my mind. I don't know how to answer that.
He's doing really, really well. I don't think any parent with a kid like Jonathan could hope for an outcome better than the way he's doing now. It's really great.
When we and
advice that Jonathan had on autism. We did not anticipate that Jonathan would be able to be independent.
Anytime a parent has a child with special needs, you're kind of instantaneously immersed into this different world for which you have no background, training, or anything, and you have to sort of figure it out as you go along.
And there is this big anxiety about the future. He will never have a job, he will never have a friend. At the end of high school, we got in touch with CIF.
CIF has several services, direct services that it provides.
So that's work where an individual with disabilities works one-on-one with a life skills tutor.
We're taking an inventory of their current skill level and identifying areas that need to be grown or developed to make them able to live more independently in the community.
And we're also working with employers to match individuals up.
Monday through Friday, I go to work at Solomon Cordell Benz. Hey, Kameh, good to see you.
He does a lot of different things for a lot of different departments beyond the different small things that he does.
Rebecca Crispy, you have a piece of mail. Kim Crotty, you have a piece of mail. Guess what day it is? Hump Day!
Come in every single Wednesday and say, Happy Hump Day. It's awesome. You can hear him throughout the entire office, like going around telling everybody Happy Hump Day.
Yes, we did. Yes.
His job is giving him the possibility of living independently, paying most of his rent.
CIF has four different residential options that have been created over the last 12 years.
The house has a community builder in it in case he needed it. Adam is a great roommate for Jonathan, and they really get along very well. That's something that us parents were very happy to see, really.
Very cool. So, do you guys have any questions for Jonathan so far? Or do you want to hear a little bit about what his daily life is like?
I have a question for you. How do you feel that you're independent?
Yeah, it feels great to be independent because I get to make my own choices, I get to make my own decisions, and I like to plan things out, I like to prepare things ahead of time.
When the need arose in schools to help students with their transition plans, CIF was a natural. Whether we're moving from middle school to high school to post-secondary, CIF supports adults in transition.
So Center for Independent Futures, let me do my need, Jonathan. So for example, Jonathan.
The online tool is a new format that we're developing. There's a skills inventory included, person-centered planning, goal writing. A huge part of the tool that will be especially useful for schools is the data collection piece, so that schools are able to record and articulate what the students are doing in terms of their person-centered goal writing.
We are so excited to be able to be in these programs, to be in these schools and working with educators and with students and their families.
So good morning, everybody. I'm sorry, we're just a little late starting.
As trainers, we only have you 2 days, okay? It would be great if you heard all about community, and then you heard all about housing, and then you heard all about support.
CIF has been able to take the process that they experienced and went through in creating alternative housing options and put it into a training program for other families in other communities.
In what you saw last night, did it expand your vision or your dream?
It's very good to see what the end product looks like.
Yes, well, we watched TV there.
We were able to go and visit the gentleman in their own apartment and really see firsthand a way to think about a different future.
Everybody here is committed, and I'm committed to help everyone individually and to work together. I mean, we're all in this together, okay?
The Maryland DC group that it's in is helping to fill a huge need.
We are following CIF's model, but we are obviously toning it to be how it works for us in the Washington, D.C. area.
To create a future, not for people with disabilities, but with people with disabilities, that's really what makes the difference.
Welcome, welcome. Hey, Dad, good to see you.
Our vision for CIF lets families have a peace of mind that if they aren't here, we still will be.
Yeah, Jonathan, it's Megan.
It's hard to describe. It's such like an emotional thing for me, and in a positive way. I care for them so deeply, and it's just a big thing. It's an awesome thing.
You know, we trust the people who run this organization. They've earned the trust of, you know, numerous families. It's a really remarkable thing.
And Snaf, I think Jonathan is close to having achieved a lot of his potential, living very independently, taking transportation and friends, and having a job. I think this is something that you can't create yourself. You have to have this wonderful organization, CIF, to help you do that.
It's important to have a dream. It's even better when the dream actually comes true.
Yes.
That's Jonathan and his family. I wanted to just share with you saw in the video that there are three kind of categories that we work in. First of all, we do provide direct services to individuals with disabilities who live in the Evanston area, and we just opened a satellite office in Highland Park. So we are providing some direct services. We are not a state-funded, state-government-funded agency. So while parents come and might bring home-based waiver dollars to help buy services, we don't take any money directly from the government in any way, okay? So that is something you need to know and understand about us. We decided, again, these two moms said they wanted to create something different. And so they didn't see that through the government-funded systems, what they were trying to do. Any help to just bring up my PowerPoint again? Thanks. The things that we do is, again, direct services, but then we also work with schools and agencies to train in-person-centered approaches. Over the time period since we've been open, we developed a lot of models for planning, for inventorying life skills, and for training life skills. And that's me. Thank you. And so we've been working in that area as well, working going into schools and agencies to train in-person-centered approaches. And then the last area that we do is this housing initiative, which we're here to talk about today. And that is, once we opened models in our area, we said people need to know how to do this. And to be able to give family groups of people who come together and want to create something new, a way to do that, let's share what we have done and put together a training so that they know what questions to ask, what the pathway is to kind of creating alternative options, and then bring resources to the table in terms of how you find people in community to support that work, you know, what kind of resources do you do research on and find, you know, that you need. So we're going to talk a little bit about that training at the end of this presentation, but right now I'm going to turn it over quickly to Ann to talk about housing in Illinois, which is the sad news, right?
Probably heard a lot. Yeah, I often am hesitant to even go over these because I think most everybody sitting in this room already knows these statistics. And Jackie, you've got the clicker, right?
Okay, great.
Again, Ed was mentioning this earlier this morning when he was talking about general SILA funding and different type of structures that SILAs can take. And so here's the national perspective. People living in 1 to 6 person settings, 77% across the United States. Illinois, 42%. Dollars spent for 6 or fewer person settings, 80% of the dollars across the United States are spent that way, but in Illinois, only 50%. And then when we were talking about state institutions, you know, 14 states have no institutions, but we have 7 in Illinois. And then integrated employment services, 18% across the United States, and 6% in Illinois. So we have our challenges. But one thing I want to point out, and I, you know, this doom and gloom is not what I always like to be focusing so much on, but it's a reality we work with, is that our focus with housing is often about bringing together groups of families and always, always looking at natural supports. Because as we work with family groups across the country, which we do, there's never, ever going to be really enough funding, no matter where you are. So you always have to be thinking creatively, how do you create that life, and how do you make sure you utilize all the type of supports, natural supports, You know, I think STAR program is an amazing example of really engaging the community with all the volunteer hours and the commitment that that organization has with that special relationship. But you have to be thinking outside the box. As a state perspective, we're 44th out of 50. These are out of the State of the State in Developmental Disabilities 2013 report. As far as we're 44th out of 50 for funding community-based disability services, 49th out of 50 for residential placement community settings of 6 or less, 70% of individuals with disabilities live with family caregivers, and of that, 23% are over the age of 60. Right?
Caregivers.
But, I mean, caregivers, right? So what happens when that caregiver can no longer be the caregiver? 21,000 plus on the PUNS list. And so I think it's always great to talk about that funding. And there's, of course, that, you know, the crisis situation where maybe you'll get funding sooner. But there's a lot of people that sit on that PUNS list for a very long time. I don't, you know, for some families, they've decided waiting to see what happens with the PUNS may not be my plan A. So I think that, you know, it's just something to be, it's a reality. Got the next one? But the good news, right? And Cherokee, you know, referenced it a little bit earlier, but the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services require that home-based, community-based services are going to be person-centered. They have to be integrated and support full access to the greater community, be selected by the individual based on needs and preferences, allow individuals to receive services in the community to the same degree as those without labels. So if you want to go to the Y, you should be able to go to the Y. You don't need to be able to go to a special program just for someone with special needs. If you're able to take advantage of the Y or your other local opportunities in your community, you should be able to do that. Support opportunities to seek employment and work in competitive, integrated settings. These final rules that came out are requiring agencies to really provide a person-centered approach for their services. It will be effective March 2019. Agencies have been given 5 years to get ready and implement these changes. So that's all really good and positive for our kids, for us as family members, and I think really a good positive change that you're seeing across the country and certainly from the federal government. So that change is coming. But, you know, even with change coming from the federal government, how quickly it happens, you know, will still depend on available resources and the determination of policymakers to make it happen. And as I mentioned earlier, you know, families that we've worked with, many of them decided they were tired of waiting and tried to just say, what can we create otherwise? So that was the time to change, for change for our families. And in order to do that, you know, we really have to become the change we want to create. Okay, so we're going to just scoot. You've got these other slides in your packet, so look at them, but they really speak to change and how you make that change happen. Just some general things about change, but they're important when you're looking to make it a reality. I want to go through some of our community living options that we've created with families. The first one, this is actually where Jonathan lives. So if that looks familiar from the movie, it is. And this was created in 2003. It's a three flat. We have a community builder who lives in the top flat. And right now, two gentlemen live in on the first floor and two gentlemen live on the second floor. Well, the next one, Jake. And just so you know, that is owned by someone in the community originally who wanted to make it available for people with disabilities to have a place to live in the community. So people just rent. We rent from them, rent from the landlord, and the individuals rent. Here, 930, we call this our 930 Chicago Avenue residence. This was a residence six apartments up. mixed use. You can see commercial on the bottom. And this was created or purchased by a group of families who came together and formed an LLC. And they purchased this, again, for the same purpose of making opportunities for people with disabilities to have a place to live in the community. Of those families that came together, only one family had a family member who ended up living here. The rest of the families truly wanted to create another option. So when people were talking earlier about reaching out and asking, there's people who want to help and people who do care, you know, there's a lot of people in our community who do want to make those social investments. This was a for-profit. The LLC is for-profit. It's not a non-profit, but they still wanted to be able to just charge rent enough to be able to cover what they needed to cover and not really looking at making money on it. And then our third and fourth opened in 2006 and 2008. And the first one that you're seeing more of, the other second one is a little further back here. We were able to secure 5 affordable mortgages there through IDA and home funds. So that was fantastic when that first was being developed. But currently about 9 different people live in one building, 9 in the other. But in total, there's about 70 units. So this is completely integrated living within the community. And we have a community builder who happens to live in each one of those residences. People own their condos or rent a condo. And it's either, in their, you know, they hold it in multiple, various different ways. Some in special needs trusts, some of them directly.
Great. So we asked one of our parents to come. And this is her son, Jonathan. And she's going to spend a few minutes just talking about what it was like to be in the beginning wave of this. So she was in that first family group that met and tried to make this thing happen. And so she's going to share a little bit of her story.
I'm happy to be here. Is this okay, volume? Okay. My Jonathan lives on the first floor, below the Jonathan you just saw. And my Jonathan is 32 years old now on the autism spectrum. And I'm one of the few people who did not raise a hand and say I'm scared to death. Because he's been in this apartment living a better, more independent life than we would have predicted. Thanks to pioneering vision in the CIF, where he said the pioneering vision. And I guess I'm here because I'm a pioneer parent here from the beginning. Quick, but the joke was that one of the other pioneering families back 25 years ago or so, we compared notes about services. I've been on the Illinois Council of Developmental Disabilities for 10 years, so I know the state of the state. I know all those statistics about what the state is not funding. Another parent, friends, said, well, 25 years ago, I think services are better in Colorado. Do you think we have to start a wagon train and go there? No. You can be pioneers and stay here and create the kind of community that CIF has facilitated. A lot of the early meetings, there was no Harrison Street, there was no bricks and mortars, so it was a lot of process of creating a community. You've heard a lot of different creative models today. Someone that was a consultant for Northwestern, and they have done all these wonderful partnerships. Families together, a lot of process of decision making. There was a committee I know on housing criteria. What we want? Well, safe neighborhood, near public transportation, walking distance to shopping. And because my son lives on this wonderful residential tree lined street, it also happens to be a block from Central Street in Evanston with merchants. And he walks maybe 4 blocks north to go to the bank, do his shopping. But along this business district, like any of us, he put this on his own. He learned how to structure his free time because it's coffee houses. He met a merchant who for a while, before she moved the business, she was like an aunt. He went in once, he didn't have enough money to buy some books. He asked her, can we do some problem solving? We have a problem solving method we use, a model we use a lot. And he first said, will you give me $2? No. so he started sweeping out her entryway. He also knows the people in the flower shop, and goes in and has met the cats there. I called him on our lunch break so he could go to the spice house and buy me some spices. So location, location, location for your loved ones, it makes a difference in his life. The coming together and creating community process, Jack asked me to talk about challenges. At first, there was impatience. Yes, but when will there be a building? But some of the good work we did, besides the committees, like the Housing Criteria Committee, the getting to know you, one homework assignment was, and I think all this is in some of the trainings that CIF does now. So I would say my family's journey has been a good one because of the visionaries and the people they learned from, and you should learn from the resources you've heard today. So one homework assignment was come back with a collage about your family. So this was 2003, my son was still in high school. His future was not up for grabs. He did go to a post-secondary program, PACE, at Mr. National Lewis, and one thing that was good was in that program was creating the expectation of living in an apartment. In fact, the young man, Jonathan Schumann's roommate, was a PACE graduate too. But back in 2003, when families came together to get to know each other and their issues, we had to create a collage. So the home family collage, a big wall on the wall. You know, we put a poster on the wall. And then they made a booklet for us. So Jonathan was just 19-year-old, and I wrote this for our family. He had just written a bio poem in school. He called himself, "Nice to be around, caring, funny, and kind." Jonathan's also an Eagle Scout. And he had just given that the year before. What I wrote at the time is that we've been pretty successful navigating the school system and with many IEP meetings, which I'm sure you're all aware of, some more problematic than others. And to go into one particular IEP meeting and made up a mantra, "We will get what he needs." That's when you're getting something from the system, right? We will work with teachers and persuade them. CIF, well, the families are called the Community Living Option Group. It's a different model. They're not the traditional agency, and there are limits, financial resource limits, to some of the agencies. But so our mantra, my mantra for coming together with other families was, we will create what Jonathan needs. And words that described us 13 years ago, our family, we were supposed to do that, still overwhelmed at times, advocates, hopeful, committed, partners, and members of the community. And just to do one more plug for CIF, if this sounds like a testimonial, it is. The Illinois Council on Developmental Disabilities gives grants to help foster inclusion in the community. And one of the coolest ones I've seen in 10 years is called A Life Like Any Other. CIF is one of five or six organizations that got this grant. When I read it, it came out of another committee, not the committee I serve on the council. Didn't write it, and I couldn't even discuss it because my son might benefit. I signed about 100 ethics, you know, conflict of interest statements a year. So I didn't advocate for CIF to be awarded this grant. What it is what should happen everywhere, and organizations find people to help the people with disabilities become better integrated in the community. Jonathan Schumann, who you saw, was a CIF participant. He's had an annual Oscar night party for 3 or 4 years. He's the film. That's one of his many areas he will tell you about. You mentioned an actor. He's, you know, he will tell you. So he wanted to do something. He told his parents he wanted to do something. around Phil. CIF, they're bridge builders through this grant. And again, this is the thing CIF people would have done without a grant. They do naturally to help people be part of the community. His bridge builder, CIF person, connected him with a documentary filmmaker. So the last Oscar night party at Jonathan Schumann's, I heard about that and he said, oh yeah. So she's teaching me how to do film editing on some computer program. You will hear, I hope you will hear agency people and others who deal with talking about person-centered planning. It's a buzzword now. Make sure people walk the walk as long as well as just saying that. And to finish with, you probably want to leave time for questions, so.
Okay, we're going to rush through the last few slides here. What I wanted was here to be able to talk to you. So we do this training, and the training that we do with families, we take them through 4 full-day workshops, and then we consult in between with the families. We have them come to Evanston, and they see our community options. They talk to our parents. They meet the individuals that we provide support to. And we do work around with Dr. Paul Arnson from Northwestern University, community development, what you need to be able to do to put processes in place to work together so that when the hard questions come up, you don't just fall apart, because that's what happens, is people get up in front of each other with hard questions, if you've ever been in a group like this, and the hard questions don't get attacked, and pretty soon there isn't anybody coming to the meetings anymore. So we work with families to kind of work through those hard issues and answer those questions. We then go through a session on housing. We bring in our housing team, our real estate attorneys, our housing developers, our architects, the folks that we've built a team around, and teach people about what you need to be looking for as you build your housing team with the folks that are in your communities to create these kinds of options. The next thing we do is talk about moving ahead, which is around supports. So we work with you on identifying your own support criteria. What do you really want for your kid, and what do you really need in terms of support? And then interviewing service providers in your area to see whether or not you, in fact, can get what you are trying to build and how you need to make that happen. When CIF started so long ago, we couldn't find those service providers, so we started providing the services for the groups of families that we were working with. And then opening your doors, we talk about the challenges that come once you've actually somehow secured a house. And you know, you heard these different ways that we've secured houses. We don't own anything except for one condominium building. The families bought a unit, we're renting others. So, you know, so we talk about once you've got that and you've got people identified to move in, and we give you all the tools to figure out that, then what happens next? And usually there's a time period where everything is great, and then there's kind of a drop off, kind of like when other kids who don't have as many challenges go off to college and everything's really good, Mom, and then suddenly it's the bottom fell out and they're calling you and going, this is horrible, bring me home. And then it all kind of evens out. So you go through that process, we kind of talk about the tools we have in place to help manage through those processes. And then I'm just going to slip to the end. Sorry, there's a lot that we thought we could say that we just didn't have the time for. Okay, so just these are the 3 buildings that we talked about that we worked with creating in Evanston. These are the STAR buildings. STARs went through our training with us, and so you heard Ray talk about his experiences and what they built at the STARs. There's a couple other options. There's one that we worked with in Schaumburg out here in Community Choices in Champaign went through our training and opened a house out there. They have 4 individuals living in that one. In Platteville, Wisconsin, we've got a group of families that came from across the country who were working with FASD, and they created a house in Platteville, Wisconsin. And we've got a few others kind of on the docket right now. We've got Inclusive Living Opportunities in Washington, D.C. You saw her on the film. They are just getting ready to open their first pooled resource opportunity, and that's going to be individuals living in an integrated apartment building and renting. And then in Grand Rapids, we just finished a training with a group of families there. So we're busy out there trying to train families how to make this happen in their own community. We don't like the idea that your kids have to think about moving someplace that's not familiar to them, that in fact you can create these kinds of things together, and that families coming together is a much stronger group than just families trying to create their own thing. So that's what we believe and how we've been doing the work that we've been doing since 2002. So, And questions, Ann?
In the interest of time, we'd love to have a couple questions while we're setting up the AV for our next speaker. So are there any quick questions that these ladies can answer? Anybody? I have a quick question about your training. Great presentation. If the 4 days, is there like a specific way to get in touch with you if you want to be part of this? How does that work?
In your folders, there's a brochure about our training. There's also a card with our full life model on it. It looks like this. And there's a phone number. And if you want to call and talk about the possibility of going through this, then the phone number in there, you can reach me, Jackie Eddy. So use that number to call. And we have done this with family groups who actually have service providers who come with them that they've already identified that they want to provide services. We've done that as well.
I have a question. Can this training be brought in front of a larger group? I'm over here.
So our first group is 13 families. We've trained 19 families, you know, it can be definitely.
Just to do a follow-up on that, though, we find that 5 to 8 families for a family group is probably best for facilitation purposes, and a family representation to us is 2 people. It's either 2 parents or a parent and a sibling.
How about a nice round of applause?
Thank you.